What is up, guys? It has been raining for the past week or so, but you know what? It's still a beautiful morning. And welcome to our first podcast. I'm super excited to get started with you guys and start talking about some of the concepts that I want to bring up today. But for the past week, it's just been thundering, storming all day. And I don't know, it's felt, when it rains, you know, you feel kind of cozy, but at the same time, it's like, we're already going through the pandemic. Now I got to deal with this too. But it's also given me a chance to really think about the book that I just finished, Louise Hay's You Can Heal Your Life. And I think that she brings up a lot of important concepts in that book. And I definitely believe her when she says that she has this uncanny ability to help people without making them feel like victims or making them feel like they are inadequate or whatever they went through defines them. I really believe her when she says that, because the way that she writes is incredibly vulnerable and human. I mean, she includes her own story at the end of the book, and I'm not going to spoil it for you guys that want to read it, but she has been through a lot, and she actually she really popularized the idea that illnesses can be caused by the emotions that we are harboring. And one example is cancer. So let me just make sure that my mic is good. Okay. So as she said, one example is cancer. And I found this really interesting how she, towards the end of the book, she has this whole list of like every single ailment imaginable. And she lists the cause and then the affirmation that you're supposed to use to really solve that problem, to really give yourself the relief that you want. And she has some on there that's like, she has one that's like buttocks, like loose buttocks, and that's a loss of power. Not in a million years would I have imagined that that's what that means. But there's a lot of interesting stuff there. And I found it actually really, really interesting that cancer was resentment stored in the body. Cancer is resentment. And then I think a brain tumor or brain cancer is when I think you judge yourself too harshly, or you rely too much, you judge things from a place of just being dry and analytical. But I might be wrong on that one, but I know that she describes her illness when she got cancer in the pelvic region because she was actually sexually assaulted. So it made a lot of sense to her why she was kind of shut down sexually, and that's why she got pelvic cancer. Yeah, pelvic cancer. And she started doing all this work and basically going to these new age or new alternative science meetings trying to figure out how she could release that resentment. And I thought that was really interesting. That really resonated with me, because in my own experience, when experiencing a lot of anger towards someone or experiencing a lot of resentment, I actually feel like I'm getting choked up, but I can feel the physical symptoms. It feels like there's rocks in my chest, actually. And I don't know if you guys feel that as well, but it's always been apparent to me that each emotion has a different place in the body. Like, when I'm feeling joy, it feels like I'm not only light, but I'm also motivated. It feels like the beginning of a marathon, basically. And it's when I feel sad, I feel this sort of heaviness. But the thing about emotions and their place in the body is that sometimes we are very tense in the body. And there's a great book called In Touch by John C. Prendergast. And he's actually he's licensed in psychology, but he does a lot of work with clients where he goes through basically the physical symptoms of what's going on in the body. He talks about awareness a lot and watching thoughts as they go by. And that actually really resonated with me. I actually wanted to make a video on that. So you guys are going to see that soon in the channel. But he does this work with clients, and it's very enlightening that he shares some of the experiences that they had. Like one woman, she felt as though there were thorns blocking her heart, and then she finally went past those and discovered that her inherent purity. And apparently she started dancing up and down like a little girl and like just having this very visceral experience, this very vivid experience in the body. And that really made a lot of sense to me. And that's sort of what these metaphysical people talk about, is having this inner knowing in your body. And what Louise Hay talks about a lot is that the body's always trying to communicate. And cancer is the body's way of saying you have deep resentment that you need to release. You have forgiving work to do. And the reason why it's called work is because it's not like you can just say, I forgive you, and then that's it. Because when you carry resentment for that long, it's already there. It's already stored in the body, and we have to find ways to clear that out. That's why people can't just think. That's why sometimes affirmations just don't put a dent in whatever it is, because, you know, an empty cup is the only cup that can be filled. And that's so true. It's not like we're already full of hatred towards ourselves and the world. It's not like we can just say, I love myself, I forgive myself, I forgive the people that have hurt me. I don't owe them anything, they don't owe me anything, I'm completely fine. I mean, you could say that, but it's definitely going to show otherwise in your life. It's going to show up in other areas. And one thing that I found extremely interesting about her book is that there's a section where she talks about how some people smoke. And then, well, there's an affirmation that she talks about where you look in the mirror and you say, I am willing to release the need in my consciousness for this specific thing. So whatever it is, cigarettes, junk food, binge eating, binge watching, whatever it is, you just say, I'm willing to release that. And the universe, she says, will take care of the rest. Because the only thing that it needs to know is that you are willing. So say this with me, guys. There's an affirmation that she uses it says, I'm willing to change. So say this with me, okay? 3, 2, 1, I am willing to change. Now for me, I notice there's a pretty noticeable difference for me. At least I can feel in my body like I'm finally starting that marathon, like I'm finally making some progress. Because, you know, you are there's a lot of dimensions to you, really, what we call ourselves. And it's like your consciousness is just using the mind and the body as tools to carry out whatever mission or life task you chose or you talked about when you come here. And that's a subject that we're gonna start delving into, because I know, at least with myself, during Corona, I have been definitely thinking about why I am here. It's the whole reason why I'm recording this. It's the whole reason why I recorded the video about breaking bad habits. It's the whole reason why I got a ukulele. I started the blog. It's because I started wondering. Wow, that's a lot of lightning right now. But I was absolutely wondering, you know, why I was here. What's my purpose? What's my role in all this? And I was actually reading this book by a man named Luis Monero, and he talks about out-of-body experiences a lot. And it really, you know, my family, has, you know, been into that. And that's half of my family is Brazilian. And in Brazil, there is a practice called conscienciology. And that's where it's the study of the consciousness, basically. It's like science, but science of you, you know, your science. So it's a really interesting thing to think about. And one of the concepts in there, and, you know, I think some different religions believe this as well. I know Hinduism believes in karma, and karma literally it translates to action. So it's really the repercussions of your actions, and there's no punishment. There's nobody that's gonna give you good things or bad things because of your karma. It's just the law. So if you do something quote unquote bad, or as we call it, negative, then maybe something negative will then happen in turn. It's just really cause and effect. You don't have to put that meaning on it. And a lot of people do this. This is why some people believe in a vengeful God, that if you make a mistake or if you sin, then God is going to beat down on you, strike you down. That's not necessarily true. Whatever you do, in conscienciology, they talk about whatever you do, putting out a thosine. And what is a thosine? It's like the energy that your thought has. And tho is the thought part of it. Seen is the emotion. So if you're having thoughts about lunch, you're putting out a thosine of lunch. And by extension, we can say if you're putting out a thosine of sadness, anger, rage, that is going to be what you attract. And it's not about, a lot of people like to talk about the secret, right? But I agree with, I think his name is Peter Sabo or something on this. But he says you attract not what you want, but who you are. So the real question becomes, who do I need to become to get what I want? Who is the person with that six-figure job, or that beautiful wife, or the beautiful car, whatever you want? Because in the end, you keep getting more of what you are. If your essence is not of somebody rich, you will not be rich. And that's a crazy concept to think about. But when you really start to analyze where you have been in your life, and you start to see some of the more successful people, like Elon Musk said that he would rather die than be successful. In his mind, he made it so that there was no other option for him than there was no other option than just being successful. But a lot of people have experienced poverty, and so that's what they're identified towards. Or you grow up around people who are binge eaters, and you start to binge eat. Even though you may not have the same level of problem, you're still, you know, like, oh, I've always done this since I was a kid. My family did this. That means that I must do it too. But that's where we really come down to breaking the cycle. And that's when you start to shift your identity. And Louise Hay talks about, at first, it was very hard for her to try to love herself, but it progressively got easier. Why did it get easier? Because that resistance, that, you know, that affirmation that we just said, that resistance started to falter, and then change really took place. And I've seen this in my personal life, where I was so tired of feeling one way that I just asked God, whoever was listening, I just said, universe, can I please just feel something else? I know what this feels like. Now can I feel something else? That, I think, is the best way to go about it. I think once you accept, oh, maybe I'm really not where I want to be right now. Once you accept that, it opens up the possibility of change. Because the amount of time that you spend arguing with yourself over whether you really are a great person, a great father, a great business person, the amount of time you spent arguing with yourself would completely be voided if you just accepted what is already happening. Then you can move on from that. It definitely takes a lot of courage to admit where you are maybe isn't where you want to be. But that's really the first step. And another really key thing is balancing the amount of effort you put in and the amount of rest that you take. Most of us are just wandering around with no purpose. And in this book of conscienceology, a lot of those concepts, it's called Demystifying the Out-of-Body Experience by the guy that I mentioned before, Luis Monero. He talks about what a pro-exis is. And this is what people in conscienceology call a life task or an extra-physical task or intra-physical goal, whatever it is. But it's basically, it's not just a goal. It's like your life's goal. So it definitely has a heightened importance. And what they talk about is that before you came here, you actually sat down with a couple of your close family and friends. You sat down with them. Think about the people that are important to you. And this is really, this is actually crazy to consider. But think about the people who are really close to you, like those people that you feel you have a genuine connection with. Now, this book, one of these theories says that you sat down with them, and then another soul called an evolutionologist, and then you all planned out what you were going to do. And think about the people that you've had long-standing conflicts with. Think about the people that you have maybe done something harmful against. Now, the lesson here is that maybe that wasn't by accident. Maybe that was, maybe that's another chance for you to resolve whatever dispute you had with that person in a previous life that's carried over. And this translates directly to karma, the action that one person has taken on you or the action that you've taken on another person. But does this mean that we have to punish ourselves for eternity because, oh, this I should have done better, I should have said something else? No. I think that whatever happens is really, if it's meant to be, it'll happen. If it's not meant to be, it won't happen right now. It might happen later. But who knows? You know, who knows? There has to be, at least I think there has to be something that's really routing this physical life, like pushing us to somewhere else. And you know, why we're here is a completely different reason than what makes you feel good. Because in our world, and I struggle with this too, it's a constant process of decision making between what is going to make me feel good and what is going to make me feel good later. What is going to help me become a happier person, or what is going to help me be happy? So you see, it's always a question between your present self and your future self. And sometimes we can use our past self to try to justify what we're doing now. Sometimes that little voice in your head, it's okay just to have one cookie, it's okay. That same voice is the voice beating you up after you do that thing. So consider that. Really think about, where are your decisions coming from? Now, something that I like to compare this to is meditation combined with action. That's really the whole you take action, then you rest. And even that rest becomes meaningful, because during meditation, what you do is you look within. And within, you're going to find the problems that are magnified in your external world. So it's almost like, it's like Survivor in a way, because Survivor, guys, if you've never seen the show before, it's like they put, I forget how many people it is, but they put about 20 or so people on an island. And then, you know, these people come from all walks of life, and then they have them participate in challenges And really, really from the start of the game, everybody's in it for themselves. Everybody's in it to get the $1 million. Or I think it was three this season. $3 million. Actually, no. Two. Because the winner of this season, he won $1 million. Then he won two this season. So that's three in total. But this season, it was two. But Survivor, it functions, that island functions kind of like a microcosm or like a smaller version, a smaller scale of society as a whole. And you get to see, of course, they're all playing for money. You're not, but I mean, it could be compared to what we do in real life, you know. It could be compared, the competition that they all go through, the struggle, the not being able to trust anyone. Because some people will tell you that you can't really trust anyone except your family. Some people will say that, and some people will just blindly follow whoever they meet. And it functions like a smaller version. And why I bring that up is because Louise Hay talks about this as well. I know I've said her name like a million times, but she talks about having something in your internal world be off. It causes a shift in your external world. And if you can take your external world and turn it into something that's constantly showing you how much you love yourself, how prosperous you are, then it's going to benefit you. And she takes her bills as proof that she has the money to pay. It's crazy to think about, because a lot of conditioning that people go through is, I don't have enough money. Money is always scarce. Either their families teach them that, movies teach them that, or, you know, whatever conditioning that you receive, it teaches you a certain thing. It teaches you that this has to be a certain way. And we do get really attached to our mind's ways of doing things. They're not necessarily the best ways. That's why some people realize how badly they've been treating themselves their whole lives. And they really wonder, you know, I don't even treat my worst enemies this way. Why am I treating myself this way? I don't even treat bad people with the disrespect that I give to myself. Why do I do this? And the moment that you ask why do I do this will be the moment that you truly, you make that internal change. And that is what's going to lead to an external change. One really interesting thing that she says is that fat people, overweight, the condition of being overweight is because you don't feel like you have enough safety. That's why you pack on the pounds, because you feel like if you do that, it's going to make you safer. And in a way, it does kind of make sense. Like, if you think about people who are overweight or people who have eating problems, it is never a question of the food tasting better than, you know, their will to not have the food. It's not a question of the taste versus your inherent knowing that it's going to make you fat. It's a question of what is driving you to go and have that chocolate. What is driving you? Because, you know, a lot of us have a lot of motivation, but it's not in the right places. A lot of people are motivated to go and cheat on their diets. A lot of people are motivated to go have meaningless sex. A lot of that comes from an internal reason. And that's why you look for these external things. That is a big thing. And that leads us to recognize that sometimes we are just stumbling through life. Just, it feels like we're walking through a fog all the time. And why is that? It's because we're not in touch with our proexus. It's just not in touch. And when Louise Hay wrote her first book, which You Can Heal Your Life was not her first book. Her first book, she wrote while she was working with people. And it's a collection of metaphysical why, you know, it's basically the section in her book where she talks about how emotions can cause illness or dis-ease. Get that dis-ease. You're not at ease. Your body's trying to tell you something. And when she wrote that book, she tells the story like the universe really opened up to her. And, you know, at first she started her own publishing company, and that eventually grew to be so successful. They have offices in literally every corner of the world. It was like her book was meant to be read worldwide. And that's how you know when you found your life's work. And one aspect about her that I really like is that she is like to the point. She is pragmatic and very practical. And she gives you this exercise where, and I want you guys to do this too. She gives you this exercise where you look in a mirror and you say, I love you. And then you put your name. I love you. I really love you. And most people find it hard to do that. But I think that looking at yourself in the mirror brings you a clearer picture of who you are. And why is that? Why is that? Because we continuously think that we are either stronger or we're weaker than we actually are. We think, oh, I'm feeling like this right now, I must be weak. Oh, I'm feeling good right now, I must be strong. But when you look in the mirror, and when you look into your own eyes, if you can face yourself, it takes away that speculation. It really does. And you guys are going to see this when you actually look in the mirror. Because everybody has to look in the mirror at least once a day. Like when you're getting ready. I haven't really heard of anybody that like just doesn't look in the mirror. But when you do that, what it does is it lets you see yourself. It lets you take a step back. Because your mind has no idea who you are, really. It lets you take a step back. Lets you say, okay, so who am I, really? Who is the one even looking at the mirror? Who is the person that cries when I get sad? Who's the person that laughs when I'm happy? Who is that person? When you look in the mirror, and from my own experience when I've done this, I have realized that I judge myself based on this fantasy that my mind creates. And it's just like, when I look into my own eyes, I just realize I'm just trying my best. You know, it's not that big of a deal. We tend to dramatize things that really aren't there. Think about a mistake you've made, and in the moment, it probably seemed like it was gonna completely destroy you. But now, looking back on it, you can de-traumatize that. I mean, de-dramatize, that sounded like de-traumatize. You can de-dramatize that. Maybe it wasn't that big of a deal. And, you know, we're all human. We are all human. Looking in the mirror brings you to that realization. It literally puts you face to face with that realization. And one thing that you can do is you can look in the mirror and ask yourself what you need to know. Ask yourself, what is my unconscious mind trying to show me? And if you don't get an answer, let it go. It'll come later. I think, and you know, this really resonated with me when she said this. Louise Hay, she says that once the universe knows, once you set the intention, and once you put that out there, it's automatically gonna fall into place, just like that. And when you look in the mirror and say to yourself, I'm willing to love myself. I am willing to change. I'm willing to forgive whoever it is I need to forgive. Even with all that resentment stored up inside you, I am sure that something is going to happen to bring you to where you need to be. You don't need to believe in anything. And this is where the topic of faith versus belief comes in. What's the difference? Faith comes from your heart. Belief is in your mind. I believe that the sun is going to come up tomorrow. But I have faith that tomorrow is going to be a good day. I have faith that whatever happens, you know, it's all going to turn out okay. I'm going to get what I need. Other people are going to get what they need too. I believe that, you know, belief is based on proof. It's objective proof, facts. And if you don't have those facts, as we don't many times in life, you can just have faith that whatever is the best for you is going to work out. Does this mean that you don't have doubts? Of course not. Doubts are healthy. Doubts are what made our ancestors survive basically everything. That's why nobody jumped off cliffs. Because you have those doubts. Those doubts are what keep you alive. So you can actually look at your doubts as something good. And once you do that, once you look at your fear of trying new things or opening up to people as something that signals to you that change is happening, that's when you won. That's when you know that you are going to make progress regardless of whatever happens. It's very hard for some people to look in the mirror. It's very hard for some people to admit that things have gone wrong. Things have gone wrong. But does that mean that all is lost? Of course not. I think Corona is really forcing a lot of us to take a step back. And those people that can't take a step back are really suffering right now. And I think that we all struggle with that to a certain degree. I know that... Actually, my mom told me this. A lot of young people in I think it was Brazil, but I know a lot of young people across the world are really struggling right now. Suicide rates are going up. And that's because when people don't have the external distractions to fall back on, it can seem overwhelming. A lot of people are finally realizing that they have to face themselves. Now you can't just go out to the club, start partying, start talking with your friends again just to forget about all your troubles. You can't do that anymore. A lot of people have been finding that they're just uncomfortable. It's like with the cigarettes. Once you take away those cigarettes, you find, oh, what's making me do the cigarettes? The cigarettes are just a symptom. What's the real problem? A lot of people are having to confront that. And if you don't have the necessary tools, it can seem like all your emotions are just completely overwhelming, completely untangible. You just cannot deal with them. And that's what it can seem like to a lot of people. That's why practices like the mirror work, it have to be used knowing that you are inherently good. There's nothing wrong with you. And you don't have to beat yourself up because a part of you doesn't want to change. That's the part of you that eventually is going to bring you the most joy when it does change. That's the part of you that's going to give you the richest experiences. Now, So I did mention In Touch, and in that book, he talks about how some people, as they start meditating more, they suddenly become identified with this idea that they are a passive observer. And this is a very common, actually, this is a very common pitfall that most people fall into. They think that because they're able to take a step back finally, if they've gotten that far, then they think that that is just them. The step back version of them, that's them. And what I'm here to tell you is that that's not only you. You are both the person giving and the person receiving, or the person watching and the person being watched. And we'll use an example. So you get angry in the car. And most people, they just focus on, they get too identified with the idea that they were supposed to be the ones on time. And they forget that that person is in a hurry too. But let's say this, you get mad in the car And some people are going to be able to take a step back and say, you know, why am I so worked up over this? It's just traffic. It's just cars. This happens every single day. So why am I so worked up? And some people think that because they're able to take a step back and really look at their anger, that they are not the angry person in the first place. You are both. You are both. That's the way it's meant to be, because life, it's a very simple expression. Life is meant to be lived. You are meant to live. You are also meant to not get attached to your life. It's both at once. And it can seem very, very confusing. But that's definitely where awareness comes in. And I like to compare awareness to a flashlight. It's like whatever you put your attention on, you're shining the light on. Now, what are you? Like, who is the person listening to this podcast? That would be the awareness. The awareness that you call whatever your name is. That's your awareness. And your mind is just, your mind and body are both tools for you to use. I know I mentioned this before. They're just tools. And if you want to use them in the best way possible, you can. If you want to refine them and bring them to the highest good, then you absolutely can. But why are we able to do that? What's even letting me speak into the microphone right now? Because I can. I can think a thought and think, I can think these exact words. Okay, speak. Get your point across. But does that do anything? No. It's the actual willpower that comes from your consciousness. It's the actual willpower that helps you take in information. Because when you're not paying attention, maybe you won't remember as much as if you used your will to gather whatever is going on. And it's really about putting your awareness on whatever it is that's actually important to you. And I think that is kind of where honesty comes from. I think honesty is when you acknowledge your emotions, but you still play by quote unquote the rules, or you don't get, you acknowledge your emotions, but you don't get too identified. You don't take things personally. You just say, look, this is what happened. This is how I felt about it. This is what you said. This is how it made me feel. And you just are aware of that whole situation. You don't let things get to a point where you are constantly trying to defend yourself, constantly trying to fight for the right to be right. And a lot of people fight for that because they think that once they get that, it's going to solve every single other problem. They think that if you finally feel right in a situation, then suddenly every single action that you took up to that point is going to feel right as well. Well, that's simply not true. That's simply not true. You have to look at the situation as a fresh new thing, because that's all it is a fresh new situation. All these narratives that we come up with are just in our own minds. Do you think, I'll give you an example. So somebody who's an Olympic athlete and has failed every single time before the big race, right? The big one. And maybe he's failed and he's been telling himself, oh my gosh, I'm doing so bad. I'm going to fail the next one. He is going to do worse than if he had not said anything to himself at all. He's going to do much worse than someone who is not even a runner, but is just participating, maybe snuck in through the back door of the Olympics and is now participating in the race. So what you're allowing your awareness to soak up is very, very important. And this is why I used to be such a big fan of scary stuff. I used to, you know, when I was a kid, I remember watching the Slenderman video, the Slenderman creepypasta. And that was really, I was a fan of, like, not of, like, that stuff, but, like, of feeling scared. Because that's what, quote-unquote, horror movie fans, that's what they like. That's why. That's why some people are addicted to feeling unhappy. And I struggle with this, too. It's because you can feel that when you're scared, you can also feel excitement. Excitement and fear are just two sides of the same coin. Scientists have, they've basically deducted that you can feel quote-unquote positive and quote-unquote negative emotions at the same time. It doesn't matter. You know, you don't have to label it, oh, I'm feeling this way, so I must not be able to feel a certain way. No, it's much more complex than that. Some people get high from being afraid. This is why trauma victims constantly stuck in the fight or flight response. And it is truly exhausting to be on that adrenaline high all the time. And that is what they're dealing with. I think the worst thing that you can do to a child isn't the actual abuse. Because once that's all said and done, that person is going to be left with an addiction to conflict, to confrontation. They're going to want to be right all the time, because if they don't get all their anger out, it's going to feel like they didn't win. This is why some people who have gone through trauma, they constantly find themselves in situations where they are like the victim. They are the one being tormented or inconvenienced by someone else. They are never the one actually doing that. Why? Because they may always be looking for the perpetrator and the victim of a specific crime. They may always be looking, because that's what your reticular activation system has been trained to do, is look for signs of those situations so that you could keep yourself safe. And a lot of people talk about how the brain is wired for survival. And the problem is, when you wire a child's brain solely for survival and not for a happy, healthy, wealthy life, the only natural course of events is for that child to ultimately end up unfulfilled. Why? Because you're still alive. You're not happy. You've really lost touch with your humanity or your vulnerability, but you're still alive. And it's kind of, you know, this podcast took a dark turn, but it's just something to think about. The thing is, though, is that we can always change. And that's the point that Miss Hay wanted to bring up so badly. We can change who we are. Who we are is not stagnant. It doesn't stay that way for the rest of your life. Some people believe that you can never change your personality or who you are at the core. But personally, I don't really buy into that. I think that whoever is needed at the time, that's who you become. Whoever you need to be is whoever you can become. But before we need to do that, we have to face ourselves. What is going on right now? And a lot of people dealing with grief are such a heavy emotion, grief. It takes up such a large space in the body that it feels like you're almost drowning in it. But those emotions, and this is what's really interesting, those emotions like shame, grief, and anger, they're all at a certain frequency. And that frequency is, I know David R. Hawkins talks about the scale of consciousness. And on this scale, there's a bunch of emotions that you can experience. And I think shame, apathy, anger, they're low scale emotions. But the thing about anger is that it's the most resonant. So have you ever listened to a song where it's like a harmony comes on, or like multiple people are singing the chorus at once? They're resonating. That's what anger is. That's what anger is. It makes you feel like you are resonating with all of these other, this angry energy, and you're about to take that and do something with it because you feel so powerful. Anger and courage are two sides of the same coin. You can be courageous without getting angry. You can stand up for yourself without getting angry. But a lot of people have been trained that anger is powerful. Oh, men don't cry. Men are angry. Men, they use anger to get where they want to go. Or women cannot get angry. These are both false. Both of them are false. Anger is a transition emotion or a secondary emotion. Anger signals to you that something has to change. That's what anger is there to show you. And the fact that it's the most resonant of emotions really tells you, it tells you that it's really waiting for you to take action. And a lot of people don't realize this. A lot of people, they sit. And I'm not saying that sitting with your anger is a bad thing, but they suppress it. And that's different than sitting with it. Sitting with the anger is listening to what it's trying to tell you. Suppressing is, I don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear what you're trying to tell me, so just go away. But in the end, it's not going to go away. It's going to show up in the form of cancer. It's going to show up in the form of little acne that pops up on your face that you don't know where it comes from. It's a real game changer in the way that we understand how our emotional effects are physical. Like, for a lot of people, I think this is a really great example. So Chief Keef, the rapper, he has these dreads that are really, really long. And there's an interview on YouTube where he goes on this Vice show. I think it's Vice, whatever, called The Therapist. And it's this like spiritual guy. It's this spiritual old guy interviewing people and basically talking them through all the trouble that they've gone through in their lives. And for most of the interview, in the beginning of the interview, Chief Keef, and I'm like, I'm watching this. I'm like, this is Chief Keef? Because in his songs, it's like, that's that shit I, you know, whatever. That's that stuff I don't like. Yeah, it's that same guy. And he's put in a very vulnerable position. And what he does is he covers his forehead with his dreads. He actually, like, pushes his dreads to his forehead, and suddenly they're covering his eyes. And this is similar to what a child does when they don't want to see something. It's very similar, and it shows. It's just very interesting that these signs, you know, even though you might not want to show that you're feeling increasingly vulnerable, your body is going to show it. Your body has some way of telling you. You might not show your anger, but you're definitely going to feel it as a burning sensation. Or shame. Somebody feeling shame. You know, when a baby, and I'm not saying this is quote unquote right, when a baby walks in naked at the dinner party, what is going to happen? The baby is going to be shamed. And when that baby is shamed, the baby just holds its head down. It doesn't say anything. Or maybe it starts crying. But we really teach our children what is acceptable and what's not. But the thing is, because most people were brought up with that being done in such an unhealthy way, then it just creates a cycle of suffering. And if you can't take a step back and realize that you are both the person observing that shame or anger or courage or even joy. And you are the person experiencing that joy as well. Then how can you live a life that's meaningful but also not too heavy? You see what I mean? It's like you don't want to live your life, at least I think, and I do have to admit that sometimes my emotions can definitely cloud what I am trying to get across in the moment, or what I think someone is doing is not the same thing as what they're actually trying to say. But I also think that if something makes you uncomfortable and you feel that discomfort, it's definitely your right to admit that it makes you feel uncomfortable. It's definitely important that you realize, oh, I'm not feeling the best right now. Why am I not feeling the best? Because your emotions are actually a very good indicator of where you are. And this happened for me as well. I said, oh no, I already forgave that person. But inside, what was I feeling? I was feeling resentment, hatred, betrayal. All at once. And they came as the form of a knot in my stomach. Like I wanted to throw up whenever I would see that person. I said, no, I don't feel any hatred. No, I don't feel any anger. But every time that person was around me, I felt like I was going to vomit. So the point is, life is all about balance. It's the middle path. Some things are going to make you angry no matter how you look at it. People cutting holes in their masks, and like, at least for me, this makes me angry when some people talk about like reopening things without any plan, without any like discernible solution. I guess there's no really solution. I guess a solution would be a vaccine, definitely, but that is still a long ways from now. But when people talk about that, at least I feel that resonant anger. But it's different from feeling like angry because you're about to stand up for yourself. It's different because I know that there's nothing I can do. And when you put those two together, it almost seems to me like there's no solution to that emotion. Usually, we talk about, or at least I talk about, there being a solution to every emotion. If you follow the emotion to its source, you'll find the solution. And maybe that's true with the anger and the helplessness. And I'm told that that creates rage. I actually read that when you feel helpless and you feel anger at the same time, it actually creates rage. That is why some people just have like a mental breakdown about the things that they cannot change. There's a song by John Bellion. It's the last song on his album The Human Condition, and it's called The Hand of God, and it's really like an overture of the entire album. It brings like all the songs into one. Fantastic production. He has a line on there where it's like, tears at a funeral, I might break, angry at all the things I can't change. So it's like it really reflects that sense of not being able to change something, but you're still stuck with the emotion. And it's very hard. It's very hard to deal with. I'm gonna admit it straight up. I'm the first person to tell you. I love positivity. I love trying to be the best in your own life. But I think that a lot of people fall into the pitfall of just trying to spin everything in a positive way. The thing is, you can actually do that. You can actually do that just like what Louise Hay did with her, what she did with her bills. She said, these are proof that I can pay my bills. These mean that I have the money. I guess you could do that with Corona by saying, well, you know, the environment is thriving right now, even though people are, I think my county is reopening today, actually. But so nature is doing really well. A lot of people are now having the time to take a break from the daily grind. I know that for me, it definitely helped. I wouldn't have bought a ukulele. I wouldn't have started this blog if it wasn't for Corona. Starting this blog has really fulfilled me in ways that it's just brought so much joy to me that I hadn't felt in such a long time. And I'm so grateful that I was able to, that I am able, I don't know why I'm talking like this, that I am able to do this. I really love doing this. And so you can look at it that way. You can look at it, oh, now I have the time to finally start my passion project. Now I have the time to finally pick up painting again. I know that we actually painted for Mother's Day. Me, my dad, and my brother painted 3 pictures. My mom didn't paint because she wasn't feeling well that day, but we painted. And I found myself really liking my painting. I had this passion for drawing. And for a while, I drew sporadically. For a while, I just wanted to get better at drawing. But then I gave that up because I wanted to pursue other things. I wanted to start working out more, meditating more. And so I did that. And I made substantial progress. But in the process, I think what happened to me was that I had this very rigid expectation of how things were going to go for me. I had this very rigid expectation of what my life was supposed to look like. And it's not very wrong. It's not, excuse me, it's not wrong, inherently bad to have those expectations. But at the same time, they're going to make your life so much harder than it has to be. Because life should be like, you know, life is like a box of chocolates. But not in the way that everybody thinks it is. It should be like you open that box and then you choose whatever you want. It should be like achieving your goals is effortless. It should take you less effort and more surrendering or more resting to achieve a goal than it does. But a lot of people are brought up with the premise of hard work. Hard work. But it doesn't have to be hard. All you have to do is be smart about it. And there's a guy that I watch on YouTube named Quasi Joe here. I think he's a really great teacher. I really do. And I think he is a really great person. And he has shared that. He has shared a lot of valuable insight to how, you know, you can balance the two yogic principles of putting in effort, you know, putting in the right amount of effort and then surrendering. I was actually watching the Great Food Truck Race with my family, and it was actually a pretty good show, actually, and I was really emotionally invested. I have to say, I was really emotionally invested. There were 2 teams in the finale, and it was Grilled Cheese All-Stars and then Coretto Siciliano, and Coretto Siciliano had Vinny from Jersey Shore, his mom, and then his uncle, Angelo. And then Grilled Cheese was 2 identical twins and then one of their friends. But I was really emotionally invested. And I wanted Coretto to win, but Grilled Cheese won. And I remember just thinking to myself, like, man, Coretto should have won. But that, it's very interesting how we can get very attached to things that aren't even ours or quote-unquote ours, as what people who just ended a relationship have to confront that in themselves. They think that that person was theirs, but in reality, nobody owes anybody else anything. Nobody owes anybody else, you know, the time of day, really. But that's not to say that if somebody doesn't give you that, then they're still worth time. It's not to say that nobody is quote-unquote worth. It's just to say that sometimes things don't work out because you can get so attached to a certain outcome, a certain way of doing things. And maybe that's not what's going to happen. Maybe that's not what's in your proexis, in your life task. And I want to close this podcast off by going over actually how to find your proexis. Now, most people think that finding your life task is going to be doing something inside. Looking inside yourself. Then other people think that it's looking outside, trying new things. I think that it's a balance. I think that first you have to say, I think I'm going to combine Louise Hay's version of this and combine what I read in Luis Monero's books. They're both very great books, and I sincerely hope that you guys check them out because they contain so much valuable information, shed some light on some very invaluable topics that really it kind of makes sense of a lot of things. But I think first of all, I am willing to find my proexis. That's what I try to put out there. I'm like, okay, I'm willing to find it. For a long time, I wasn't willing to really do anything. Now I'm willing. I'm willing to change. If you guys want to say that one more time, go ahead, because that is really, really powerful. And I also think that we need to start noticing what's right in front of us. Start thinking about what you liked when you were a kid. What ideas came up to you, not with societal pressures or not with the expectation of making money, but just because you enjoy it. Look at Jimi Hendrix. Jimi Hendrix was doing his life's worth when he played the guitar. He started off with, He started off, he was very poor. He had a guitar or a ukulele with like one string on it. And he was playing in the street to make money. Does this mean that like every person playing something in the street is doing their life's work? I don't think so. Maybe. It could be. And that's completely fine. But I think that we need to see the opportunities that are in front of us. Right now, we can't go out and take a lot of action. And a lot of people think, oh, I can't go out and take a new samba lesson, so that must mean that I can't try new things. No, you can absolutely try new things. Try starting a blog. Try recording a podcast. Try writing a book, starting your novel. And it doesn't have to be something where you completely burn yourself out trying to do it. Because when you find your life's task, it's going to give you much more enjoyment than mindlessly scrolling through Twitter every single day. All I see on Twitter nowadays is just people fighting with each other. Somebody posted something and now they're getting canceled. I think Doja Cat got canceled. So it's just somebody getting canceled every single day, somebody fighting. But let's focus on who we are. Let's focus on what's inside right now. And let's really respect that. Let's not be too hard on ourselves, because we really are trying the best that we can at any given moment. I want to close this out by saying thank you so much for listening. It means the world to me that you guys watch the videos that I post and the blog posts that I write and the podcasts that I do, even though this is the first one. But it really means a lot. It gives me fulfillment, joy, and hope, and it's really great to be sharing my ideas with you guys, because you don't have to listen, but if you got to this point, or even if you clicked on this, then just thank you. Truly, thank you. And as always, well, guys, the rain stopped. So as always, have a wonderful one, and it's a beautiful morning. Thank you.